Mr. Chairman, young Buddhist, first of all, I would like to thank you for inviting me to give this talk tonight. And you have given me a very interesting subject to talk, aspiration. Later you will come to know why it is important. Because we practice this religion not knowing the real method or the purpose of our practices, our beliefs, our traditions, and how to divert our minds when we perform a religious service or a meritorious deed, and what is the aim of our religious life. There are many things to discuss. First thing, the Buddha has mentioned, whenever we perform any kinds of meritorious deeds, naturally, we experience the good result within this lifetime or hereafter, whether we aspire or not. It is natural. This is the nature of the karmic result. But we must be wise, because we do not know what we get and how we experience. And sometimes we may get what we don't like. The karmic energy is such, it is unbiased. If you have not made up your mind, or if you have not aspired to gain something, you do not know what you gain. Therefore, the Buddha says, you can gain anything here in this world, material, worldly things, as a result of your meritorious deeds. But that is not the aim of our religious life. We should not satisfy simply by gaining something material or worldly pleasures which are impermanent, changeable at any moment. Therefore, the Buddha says you have to develop your way of thinking when you perform some religious duty or meritorious deed. If you do not aspire to liberate yourself, that means attainment of nibbanic bliss. Without your aspiration, you won't get it. Forever you remain by experiencing changeable, uncertain, worldly, material things which create some sort of unhappiness, disappointment and unsatisfactoriness in the end. Please remember this. Now let us take the Buddha's way of life. How he started his mission and how he aspired. For a long time, we cannot calculate in terms of years how many millions or how many billions or trillions. Such a long period, he had to work by cultivating his mind, by practicing all the great virtues in this world, by eradicating all the defilements or mental impurities, and by training his mind and purifying his mind, life after life, he went on developing or preparing the background for his enlightenment. That is called Buddhahood or the enlightenment. The very day when he made up his mind, he uttered these words, "I use my full effort and energy to gain my enlightenment, to release, to liberate all those who are ignorant and who suffer in this world, and pave the way for them to get rid of worldly sufferings, physical and mental." This was the inspiration that he developed in the mind, then aspired. Life after life, I work for my enlightenment. I want to liberate. I want to pave the way for all those unfortunate living beings who suffer in this world. Then we can ask, how can a person carry on the same idea, same determination, or same aspiration life after life? Because when we define the nature of death and the mental energy, consciousness, it is very difficult for us to understand the continuity, how previous life link to the next one. Not so easy to understand. But when you study Abhidhamma, it is not very difficult. There is one particular word called sankhara. This is a very important word. When the Buddha analyzed the mind, he analyzed into four kinds of energies: Vedana, Sanya, Sankhara, Vijnana. These are the five kinds of mental energies. Among those four, Sankhara is a very important word. What does it mean? Our mental habits, our mental tendencies always remain in our mind. We cannot wipe out. Our next life is conditioned or produced through the influence of these sankharas. These sankharas are responsible to shape up, to produce our character, our behavior, our temperament, our habit, our way of life, our way of thinking, and our virtues, our cruelties, our cunningness. These are the mental tendencies we carry life after life. Sometimes we go on increasing, sometimes we go on reducing. But still, defilement remains in the mind. This is a very important interpretation. This interpretation can solve a very big problem here in this world. What is that? Very beautiful parents produce very ugly children. Very intelligent parents produce stupid children. Very religious and pious parents produce criminal-minded children. And irreligious and very uncultured, uncivilized parents produce very intelligent and very religious-minded children. Where is the secret? No one can say that God is responsible for these differences. It is not a satisfactory answer. Another big problem. Some children are very kind from their childhood. Some are very cunning. Some are very wicked and stingy. Some are very generous. Some are very intelligent and stupid.